Good morning, Acts 2 Worship Center. Let's stand up together. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy, for your grace, for your love, God. Thank you that you're here with us now. We ask you, Father, to have your way in this service. We ask you, Holy Spirit, to lead us and to guide us, God, to a place of complete surrender unto you, Father. We come in here this morning with grateful hearts. We come in here this morning thankful for what you've done for us, God. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for dying on the cross. We remember you this morning and what you've done. And we come to you, Father, because you are good. We come to you, Father, because you are faithful. We just lay everything at your feet right here, right now, Jesus. We love you, God. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Through every battle, every heartbreak, through every circumstance, oh, I believe that you are my fortress. You are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. Yes, I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe in every blessing, every promise, every breath I take. I believe that you are provider, that you are protector, that you are the one I love. 'Cause I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. Yes, I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. Yes, I believe you are. Yes, we believe it. A new horizon, and I'm set on you. You meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. With a new horizon, and I'm set on you. You meet me here today with mercies that are new. Oh, all my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. Yes, I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. Oh, I believe you are. Oh, it's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. 'Cause I believe you are the way.
Yes, you are
the truth, the light. 'Cause I believe you
The nations prove. Before you, God. This is our worship unto you. offering unto you. This is a sacrifice unto you. Even if we don't feel it, even if we don't feel good right now, God, you are still good and you deserve worship. Even if our circumstances aren't how we like them, Father, you are still worth our worship. And we will set aside our feelings, we'll set aside our doubts, we'll set aside our worries, Father, because you're worth it. And that is true worship, God, that we would worship you even in the middle of a storm, even in the middle of pain, even in the middle of hurt and disappointment, God, we will still worship you because you are worthy. You are worthy, God. Let's just sing it one more time. Here I am.
Oh, here I am, I'm worshiping you.
Vamos, dígales.
Y ven, Espíritu, ven y lléname, Señor, con tu preciosa unción. Y ven, Espíritu, ven y lléname.
Señor,
y lávame y lávame.
to the room. When you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see, what we see.
Spirit of the living God, living God, we only want to hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word.
'Cause when you speak and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see, what we see. When you come into the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see, what we see.
And you know, this is all it takes for the Spirit of the living God to invade this place, is your broken, surrendered, sacrificial worship. And He inhabits, He fills that kind of space. And so, Holy Spirit, as we worship, you're here. And when you're here, yeah, you can change everything. You can change my thought. You can change my feeling. You can change my understanding. You can change my body. You can change my health. You can change my vision. You can change a relationship. You can change my direction. Lord, thank you that you're a God that changes things. And we need to be changed. Less of me and more of you, Jesus. Again today, less of me. Decrease me so that you might increase. And we love you and praise you today. Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you. The Lord bless you in the presence of God. We want to say a big God bless you if you're here today as a guest. You can be seated. Thank you. Anybody in this room today, and this is your first time, by the way, thank you, worship team, for leading us into the throne of God today. This is your first time to worship at Acts 2 Worship Center. Is there anybody here in this worship service for the first time on a Sunday to worship with us? Can I see your hand? Anybody that might be here for the first time on a Sunday? I don't see one. That's wonderful, too. You know what? You all are here. Give yourselves a big God bless you. I made it today. And we're going to worship the Lord today. So we can move right along then. We're going to continue to worship God this second Sunday of what some call Advent. I'm going to talk a little bit about Advent, maybe for the first time in my entire ministry, but it's appropriate today. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Advent in just a few moments. But we are glad to, who in the world? Jeff and Pam Spuler, bless you guys. Good to see you today. Former youth pastors that were with us several years doing a great work up in New Jersey. We're glad to have you down here enjoying some of this warm, warm Christmas here for a few days. The Lord bless you. But we're going to continue to honor God with our tithe. So God, our ushers are ready, and we say a big God bless you to you as you tithe. Time, that's fine. Take your time, take your time. Okay. Thank you, Lord, for the tithe and what it means. It means that we trust you, Lord, as our resource in everything. Especially at this time of year when everything is pulling on our purse strings. Lord, I thank you for a faithful house. I thank you for a congregation that is faithful to you first in their giving, faithful in their finances. Lord, it's going to make our Christmas even better when we keep you first during this season most of all. So we thank you for an open heaven over our lives when we walk in the tithe in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me just give you a couple of instructional things about the Christmas schedule around here. Our Christmas service will be Sunday the 23rd, 10:30 a.m., and we're going to have some special elements to that service. So we look forward to seeing you for our Christmas service on Sunday, some special presentations, special music, and things like that on Christmas Sunday, which is the 23rd. And then the next day, the 24th, Christmas Eve, we're going to do our individual family communion. We haven't done that. I don't know how long it's been, but it's been a few years. We're going to have individual communion tables across the front here. And if you've got family visiting you or relatives coming in for Christmas, come together as a family. You may never have been able as a family to have communion served to you privately. And so it's a very intimate time. So we're going to do that on the 24th, Christmas Eve, from 7 to 8 p.m. with a little dessert, coffee and dessert following. And so we want to invite you to be a part of that on Christmas Eve. It won't take long because I know you all, many of you have plans with family. But start with this. It'll be a blessing to your Christmas Eve celebrations, whatever they may be. I'm going to ask my wife to join me. We're going to do something together this year. And I want to present some Christmas cards to some very significant people around here. We do, I should say, my wife and I as pastors here, and we want to just acknowledge some folks and give them a little Christmas card blessing for all that they do to minister to us. And I'm going to start because he's out of town today. Pastor Jerry Bridgewater is with his pastor that mentored Pastor Jerry before they moved to Florida and married them as well up in Chicago. He's in failing health. He's in his 80s. And Pastor Jerry wanted to go and spend a day with his mentor, his spiritual father, up in the church that they were in for some 20 years before joining us here in Florida. But we do want to honor Pastor Jerry. He's probably not able to watch today, but if he might see it, Pastor Jerry, we do honor you and say Merry Christmas. He'll be back actually today. They get back home later today. Then I want to ask Pastor Jamil to come. Pastor Jamil Hernandez, would you come, Pastor Jamil? I want to say Merry Christmas. Thank you for all you do around here, Jamil. We love you very much. You know that. I'm just saying Merry Christmas to you and to Catherine. Whoops, God bless you. Thank you. Somebody else that we can't, nothing can happen around here without her. I don't see her in the, somebody might need to run and grab her. But where is Maggie? Where is Miss Maggie Ramnath? Maggie is our administrator and just all around everything. She ministers to everybody. She's out there doing something now to help somebody. I'm going to ask Maggie if she can get in here, and we want to give her a Christmas card. We have a couple of others. They're going to have to be rounded up too. We may as well round them up. I want our preschool and nursery and preschool director, Dee Shipley. Somebody grab Dee, find her. Somebody grab Michelle. Michelle Neff, our children's church director. What? Maggie, God bless you, Maggie. Thank you for all you do. Merry Christmas, and we love you around here. You're a blessing. I believed for years, I don't see her, so I'm going to throw her under the bus. No, I believed for a long time that Miss Abby could never be replaced. And she can't in our hearts and never will. But her role, and Maggie has stepped in a beautiful way and is just such a blessing as our administrator. And some of you don't know, but Maggie is also, I'm going to tell them, Maggie is also our custodian. And this church has never been as clean and fresh and nice as it has been since she's been cleaning it for us. So she's doing a lot, and we love her. Dee Shipley, God bless you. Dee, Merry Christmas. Thank you for all you do to minister to the babies and the pre-K children and your faithfulness. We love you. Michelle's not here today? Or no? Somebody tell me. Is Michelle Neff not here? Somebody tried to get Michelle. I don't think she's here because I know I sent for her. She is here? Okay. We're going to wait just a minute. Oh, is today the day? Okay. Somebody came to visit the kids back there today. All right, we'll just move. Yeah, that's all right. Well, she's going to get her card, and we love you, Michelle. Thank you, honey. We just wanted to honor some folks that are so faithful all year long for what they do to minister to you with my wife and I. They're a blessing to us in so many ways. Well, I told you that I'm going to keep telling you. Our new asphalt project paved the way. We're on our way, but we're not there yet. We're almost halfway. Look at that. We need 43 more spaces out of 82. We're almost, well, just a little beyond halfway, I should say, in the amount of spaces. So we want to ask you, be faithful. Do whatever you can do. Give your church a Christmas gift that we need so desperately. It's going to be such an investment in the property for many years to come. And so thank you for those of you that have given. Thank you for those of you that have given more than once. And for those of you that are clenching with your all you have on that purse strings, I pray the Holy Spirit loosen your grip and you do whatever God speaks to your heart to do and be faithful, because we're gonna reach the goal. We're almost there in Jesus' name. So let's stand. Father, thank you. It's a joy to give. Lord, this season is not about getting, it's about giving. And for those of us who have children and grandchildren and nieces and nephews, Lord, help us help them understand this is a season not to get everything they want, but to give and to help somebody else get something. Because it's a joy, it's so much better to give than to receive in every way, in every way. And so, Father, thank you, Lord. I know your hand is upon this project. Lord, people are responding. You've already responded in a miraculous way with a better estimate, a more affordable price for us. We thank you for that. And Lord, we just pray that this can happen soon and very soon. And thank you for the offering in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give. Fellowship together for just a few moments, and don't go home yet. No. If you haven't already, students, you can head out for the Accelerate Bible class. All of our students can head upstairs for the Accelerate Bible class if you haven't already done that. Well, there they are. I was trying to find. I went to the lobby and everywhere. I'm going to start this morning with our King James moment. If you have attended here for any length of time, I always point that out. So many versions of Scripture, but I grew up studying and memorizing King James, and I always refer to that translation from time to time on a regular basis. I think sometimes certain verses with those majestic King's English kinds of verbiage, I don't know, it just takes on a different meaning. But I'm going to start with one verse, and the context of this verse is John the Baptist. He's at the Jordan River preaching and baptizing people in water. Pastor, are you confused? This is Christmas, not Easter. No, I'm not confused. I know it's Christmas. John 1:29, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. The forerunner messenger who came before Jesus, announcing him this way, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. All four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, open up their writings speaking of John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ. His conception and his birth comes before Christ's. His public ministry starts before Jesus' public ministry, as he was tasked by God to be the one to announce the coming of Messiah. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Some call this season, as I mentioned earlier, Advent. From the Latin word Adventus, which means simply coming. And it's a season through the month of December of celebrating the first coming and at the same time preparing for the second coming of Christ. So I thought, I'm gonna get a little more versed about this thing called Advent that most of our mainline denominational brethren celebrate very liturgically. And so I did just a little bit. Now, I'm far from any expert. Some of you may have roots in some of the mainline experiences, and you'll be a lot more versed in this than I am. But what impressed me more than anything was the fact that in one sentence, Advent through the month of December is about remembering his birth and celebrating that, and at the same time preparing for he is coming again. The one who came is coming again. Advent symbolizes the present situation of the church in these last days as God's people wait for the return of Christ in glory to consummate his eternal kingdom. The church is in a similar situation to Israel at the end of the Old Testament. We too are in exile. We're strangers and pilgrims in a foreign land, waiting and hoping. At least we're supposed to be in prayerful expectation for the second coming of our Lord. In the same way, the church during Advent looks back to Christ's first coming while looking forward with anticipation to his second coming when he comes to claim, he returns to claim his bride out of the church. This is what the old Christmas song is talking about. The old song that goes, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Israel would sing this in expectation of Christ's first coming. We sing it now in commemoration of his first coming and in expectation of his second coming. So again, it was very intentional that God opened all of the writings of the Gospels, the four Gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, telling of the ministry of the forerunner. And now John does not announce Jesus as a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. Not much more warm and fuzzy announcement afforded to the angels. Let me read for you, and let's look at it together, how John announces the Savior. It went something like this. And do not think you can say to yourselves in Matthew chapter 3, we have Abraham as our father. I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. Wow, this is how he's introducing the Messiah to everyone. He says in verse 11, I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Ooh, that's a very different announcement than the angels gave on his announcement or pronouncement of Jesus to the world. And so, of course, we too are not praying today for Jesus to come again as a baby. We know that. Our prayer is for Jesus to come again with power and glory, when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. And the scriptures, the holy writings of scripture, end with that very exhortation that those who know and love Christ are praying, surely come quickly, Lord Jesus. But unfortunately, this image of Jesus coming again to put an end to sin and wickedness forever is frightening to some. To those who feel like they have much more to lose, but it is not frightening to the persecuted, the oppressed believers in many forgotten places of the world. It shouldn't be frightening to anyone that trusts their life to God and trusts in Jesus, but it is. In anticipation of all the gifts that so many are expecting this Christmas, maybe some aren't so crazy about the idea of Jesus coming back before Santa Claus comes. But he could. Suppose you're a Christian in North Korea. Suppose you're a Christian woman in Saudi Arabia, many other nations of the Middle East. Suppose you're a Christian living right now in Venezuela. Suppose you're a Christian whose home just blew away from Hurricane Michael up in West Florida, as I met a couple this week, drove all the way down here out of desperation to find a new place to start a new life because they lost everything in West Florida. Suppose you're a Christian whose home just burned to the ground out in California. In circumstances like those, you might eagerly pray, come, Lord Jesus, and really mean it. Church, if the promise of his second coming is unsettling for you, then you have misplaced your hope. And your hope is in this life alone. And I think we know what Scripture says about placing our hope in this life alone, we are, of all men, most miserable. Do you understand? And I hope you do. That the best life you can live now, the best life you could have now, cannot even compare to the life that He has promised to give us, which will last for eternity. I hope you understand that. And that you can begin, if you haven't been praying and speaking and declaring, surely come quickly, Lord Jesus. Starting this Christmas time, you begin to pray, surely come quickly, Lord Jesus. Because the best life you can have now is all going to burn up and come to nothing. And without Christ, we're in big trouble. And there's no going back. When the end comes, when the trumpet sounds, when Jesus appears, that's it. People that have passed from this life into the next, that's it. Don't bother praying for their soul. That's a ridiculous notion, a ridiculous religious practice that means nothing. To be absent in this body is to be present somewhere, instantly with the Lord or not, or in hell. But it's easy for us in the American way of living, the blessed life that we do have, to be like, I don't know that I really want Jesus to come back. I mean, I'm about to get that promotion. Oh, man, I'm about to get that new house. I'm about to get. Folks, it is possible, according to this book, to gain the whole world and lose your own soul. To gain the whole world and still hang yourself, blow your brains out, overdose. It's possible. This book tells us it is. And there are many people living that way right now. And I did come to say to you, don't be one of them. Never have we needed more the Advent message and ministry of John the Baptist, whose message, or I should say ministry, was short-lived, about 6 months. And his message was simple: repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. His whole being, his whole ministry, his entire existence was on fire with the reality of the one who comes to baptize us with fire. As we just read, I baptize you in water, he said, but the one who is coming will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. You might say that John had a transvision, which is the vision that sees through the appearances of the world to the glorious power and the holiness of the coming, the second coming of our Messiah, our Savior. John the Baptist, I believe, is the embodiment of a faith that is attached not to the past, but to the future. Not to the repetition of religious exercises, but to the person of Jesus. And so he takes a faith that had rested in the wisdom of the religious leaders of the day and says it now must rest in the power of God. And the Apostle Paul echoed John's ministry when he said, I don't come with the wisdom of men, but in demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. And so I believe in Advent, John the Baptist is reminding us to forever examine, reorder if necessary, our lives according to God's divine purpose and plan. Calling us to take a fresh inventory of the contents of our hearts. Any good store manager will tell you, you cannot grow your business if you do not regularly take inventory of your merchandise. Maybe you do this in your own life and maybe you don't. But I'm going to suggest that you look across the shelves of your heart today and you take an inventory. Rid your shelves of those things that do not satisfy. Rid your shelves and yourselves. That's going to play on words right there. Rid yourselves and your shelves of those items that expired a long time ago. That relationship that expired a long time ago. I'm not going to get no amens on that one. He or she who expired. No, anyway, I'm not. Seriously, maybe that expired thing is a relationship, is a job, is a habit. Maybe you ran out of joy a long time ago and you just didn't take an inventory and you didn't realize the spot on the shelf for joy was empty. And I'm not talking about joy that is fleeting based upon temporal things, but the joy of the Lord. And that's why your strength is gone, because without the joy of the Lord, you'll have no strength according to His Word. And please don't ever think you're going to find joy from a gift you hope to receive from underneath the tree or in the driveway or on your finger. Don't think that's where your joy is going to come from. Because that might be happiness, which is an emotional thing. It's something that the soul celebrates, but it's not the joy of the Lord. That only comes when we put our hope and our trust fully in Him. Take an inventory this year. I think John the Baptist is reminding us to do that. Take an inventory. I love what the prophet Isaiah in these two verses kind of speaks to this. He says in Isaiah 55:1-2, "Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat." See, some of us think that our joy is going to come from what we can spend, how much we can spend, how expensive is the item, how much money is involved. And it doesn't. Buy and eat, come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me. Eat what is good, look at this, and you will delight in the richest of fare. Eat what is good. Buy a parking spot instead. You knew, I got Jeff. I have to slide those. He knows what I mean. I have to slide that in as much as I can. He came telling us, "Come unto Him, come unto Me, where we will find everything we need to satisfy every desire of our hearts." And you see, here's the thing. I can't change myself. I must have power from outside of myself to be changed. And that power, folks, is Jesus. He is Jesus. That means that no previous commitments I have or previous identity or no human ancestry or specific allegiances. I won't tell them about your ancestry, baby. I won't say anything. No, right. My kids were playing around with that ancestry stuff and we got some good laughs out of that. No ranking or status will be of any consequence to bring the change that I desperately need in my life. John the Baptist instructed the crowd, many of whom were of the religious elite. Don't presume to say to yourselves, "We have Abraham. We're of Abraham. We're good. You can't get no, you know, more holier than that." John said, "God is able to raise up stones and raise them up as children unto Abraham." He just kind of canceled that claim out right there. He said, "I'm telling you of a power that is going to come from the outside, a power that is able to make a new creation out of ordinary people." People like us who have no capacity within ourselves to save ourselves. Folks, my part in God's plan to save me is real simple. My part in God's plan to save me is to have no part at all. Save my surrender. That's my part. My complete surrender to Him. Give up all power to change myself or anything about myself. So it's not the power of good deeds or inner strength, not the power of religious discipline alone. Now, John said this about those that were claiming their religious disciplines. We're of Abraham. Abraham's our father. He went on to call them snakes. That's kind of the label that got them for fronting their religious disciplines. Vipers and snakes they were called at times. Not a power from religious practice, folks. Not a power from good church attendance. It's God's power that is coming, John says. And that power would bring the change that was desperately needed in our lives. We can never tell ourselves we have better genes, better theology, or better experiences, or better humility, or better repentance that changes us. For it is God who makes us new for His kingdom. He alone changes us and adopts us into His family as sons and daughters. And this was the forerunner message of John the Baptist. He came on the scene declaring the most holy people of the day that they needed to be changed. They didn't much like that either. The one coming after me, he says, has the power to bring that change. You know you've been changed when you become less interested in receiving blessings and more interested in blessing others. You've experienced a change. Church, this power that changes us has come. And He is Jesus. And He comes into a life and that person becomes less preoccupied with their own condition and much more concerned with making someone else's condition better. And all preachers today stand in the shadow of this strange desert-dwelling man named John the Baptist. The one who Jesus called, by the way, the greatest man to ever live. And what did he say? He must increase, and I must decrease. He said, I'm not the light, but came to bear witness of the light. The light is Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. So you see, Christmas or Advent is the celebration of Jesus. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And church, the one who came is coming again. And may we equally celebrate His coming again as much as we celebrate that He came. Hello? May we equally, I love the some of the last words in Scripture. I mean, the last message given to the world by the Spirit of God in Revelation chapter 22. I want to read two verses, 17 and 20. 17 says, the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears, that's us, say, come. Let the one who is thirsty, come. Let the one who wishes, take the free gift of the water of life, let him come. Let the children say, come. Let the young adults say, come. Let the married couple say, come, Lord Jesus. Let the students say, come. Let the employed and the unemployed say, come.
Let the persecuted and unpersecuted say, come. Let the pastors and the elders and the spiritual leaders say, come. Let the young and the old say, come. Let the hurting and the healed say, come. Let the spirit and the bride and the thirsty and all those who wish to drink of the water of life freely say, come quickly, Lord Jesus, come. He who testifies to all of these things, who is Jesus, says, yes, I am coming. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. No matter my current condition, my heart cries, come, Lord Jesus. No matter how you find me right now in the moment, Lord, my heart cries, come. If you find me sleeping, come, Lord Jesus, is still my cry. If you find me working, come, Lord. If you find me retired, come, Lord. If you find me single or married or divorced, come, Lord. If you find me praying, or if you find me preaching, come, Lord. If you find me driving down the road, come, Lord. If you find me singing in the shower, come, Lord. If you find me with little or with much, come, Lord. If you find me weeping or you find me laughing, may my heart cry be, surely come quickly, Lord Jesus. Come quickly. And that's the other part of the Advent message. We have no problem celebrating his first coming. But I don't know, I'm not convinced that a great majority of God's people today are living like this. Come, Lord Jesus. We're in anticipation of your second coming. We're in anticipation that you're coming again. And look what Revelation goes on to say in Revelation 22. But verse 12 says, and behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give each person according to what they have done. You see, the Magi came to find the Christ. They came bearing gifts for him. Christ is coming again, bearing gifts for you and me. On that day, whatever you did in this life will be rewarded, and that reward will be your eternal gift from the Savior. You see, the one who came over 2,000 years ago, church, is coming again in all of his glory. Are you ready to see him? Will you rejoice at his coming? In all that you pray today, do you pray, come, Lord Jesus? I found a suggested prayer that some use during Advent season. Now, I'm not one for reading pre-printed prayers, but as I read this one, I'm like, hey, that's a good confession in that prayer. I want to ask you to stand right here. And I want to pray this over us as we close this service today. I want to ask you to agree with me as I pray this over this house, over your lives, over my life today. So let's pray. This season, Lord, come to the manger of our hearts. Fill us with your presence from the very start. As we prepare for the holidays and the gifts to be given, remind us of the gift you gave when you sent your Son from heaven. The first Christmas gift, it was the greatest gift ever. You came as a baby born in a manger, wrapped like the gifts I find under my tree, waiting to be opened to reveal your love to me. Restore to us the wonder that came with Jesus' birth. When he left the riches of heaven and wrapped himself in rags of earth, Emmanuel, God with us, your presence came that night. And angels announced, into your darkness, God brings his light. Do not be afraid, they said to the shepherds in the field. Speak to our hearts today, Lord, and help us to yield to your voice. Make us like those shepherd boys obedient to your call, setting distractions and worries aside. To you we surrender them all. Surround us with your presence, Lord. We long to hear your voice. Clear our minds of countless concerns and all of the holiday noise. Slow us down this Christmas. Let us not be in a rush. In the midst of parties and plannings, we wait, Lord, to feel your hush. This Christmas, Jesus, come to the manger of our hearts. Invade our souls like Bethlehem, bringing peace to every part. Dwell within and around us as we unwrap your presence each day. Keep us close to you, Lord. It's in your wonderful name we pray. And together, let us say, amen. Amen. God bless you. With that, you are dismissed.